welcome back to Birds and Swords 2024. First episode. Now, we would have came to you sooner, but we got snowed out twice in the same week.
Snowed out, iced out, colded out.
We got like, 2 feet of snow that week total, I think.
Or
at least up here we did.
Yeah.
But good to be back. We're finally back. It's almost February, but here we are.
I got stuck in your driveway, but we're here.
speaking of snow, did you do some donuts
on accident? Or? Your neighbor was watching, probably thought I was like a fucked up teenager because I was like accidentally doing donuts when I was trying to park my car. Very slow donuts, too.
I was wondering what took you so long to get from like point A to point B. Yeah, Mike, why isn't she up here yet? So we had all that snow and it's still kind of sticking around. And then it rained and freezing rained. And
it's wet out there.
Sleeted and all kinds of bullshit.
Yeah.
So the driveway's mess. But we made it. So here we are. Full slate today. We got a full panel. So we've got some of Alyssa's friends. Do you want to go for an introduction?
Yeah. So we have Jesse.
Hello.
And Sid.
Hi.
Welcome. And you guys are gamers?
Oh, yes.
Yes.
So let's get to know you guys, I guess, right? Oh, so let's start with Sid. So you're a gamer, right? Or else you wouldn't be here?
Exactly. Why did you have to pick me first, by the way? That's so rude.
Jesse. So you're a gamer, right?
Aw, hell yeah.
Yeah? So how long have you been gaming?
Oh, boy. As soon as my brother let me. He was always the gamer first, and then he left, and so then it was mine.
What did you play first?
I think, oddly enough, my very first game was the Madagascar game.
Wait, what system?
PS2.
PlayStation 2.
Your first game was something
Bugs Life.
Movie related.
Bugs Life. Bugs Life on PlayStation 1.
Because we already knew what it was.
It was like the hardest game. It's still so hard. I tried playing it like 5 years ago, and I still cannot get past like level 2. God. Once you get to the city, the big city, the bug cannot.
I feel like old games are just harder.
Yeah.
They just were made harder.
And I didn't have a memory card as a kid either. Oh, so no. I just had to start over every time I turned that fucker on. So
rough. Is that PS1?
Yeah.
Oh, God.
All right. Well, this isn't about you. So you started with Madagascar.
Yeah.
That's fun. PS1?
PS2. And I also had a Game Boy Advanced. The one you could see the guts in. It was pink.
Oh.
So it was like see-through. And I had Donkey Kong Country on that one.
Fun.
Oh, solid game choice.
I love that one.
Played it in the car and all that good stuff.
Yes, when I could see. When it was not dark.
You didn't have the little light attachment?
My parents were rich. No.
I didn't have that either. Don't worry.
Not at all.
Was PS2 your first system?
PS2 was, yes. And I had an Xbox at some point. And I had a PC until it broke because it was a hand-me-down from my brother because I'm still not rich. Mm. Mm. And then I went back to PS4 and now I got a PS5.
Okay.
Jessie's an artist, so she never got rich.
Mm-mm.
Yeah.
Struggling over here.
No more.
Too poor.
The whole struggling artist bit.
Yeah. It sticks with you.
So would you say you love games?
Absolutely.
So what makes you love games so much?
I think because I'm a storyteller at heart. And so I love especially games that are narrative based, and so it just kind of, that's how I relate to them, is because I love story and I love the things that go into it and all the details. I love games that have lore, like really deep, like world building. So that's kind of like why I love games like the Horizon series, Skyrim, Fallout, the ones that have big expansive worlds.
Nice. So what's your desert island game? You gotta take one game for the rest of your life.
Dishonored, specifically Death of the Outsider.
Wow, an expansion?
That's
specifically
crazy.
That one.
What, a PS3 game, I guess? The first Dishonored?
No.
Oh, that's Dishonored 2 expansion.
Yeah. It was definitely PS4?
Yeah.
I think it was 4.
Yeah, because Dishonored 2 was PS4.
Yeah. And it's just, I don't know, I just, the Outsider was specifically my very, very favorite character. I got his little mark tattooed on me. Aww. So just a whole game about him, I was like, fucking sign me up. Did not kill him.
That's not what I thought you were going to say. I mean, I didn't really have a guess. I just met you all tonight, but.
Hell yeah, loved a surprise.
Interesting. Wow, the Outsider. Cool.
That's your only tattoo still, right?
Still, yes. I'm.
It's your only gamer tattoo? Everybody's got gamer tattoos here, I guess.
Yeah.
Me.
I'm still poor, so I only have one. Yes.
5 minutes later, still poor.
We'll check in later.
All right. Awesome to have you here. Sid, are you ready? Can we go back to you now?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. All right. So what do you love about gaming and what do you play?
I play a lot of RPGs, and it's because what we kind of mentioned earlier with us talking was just escapism.
Yeah.
I didn't have a lot of friends growing up, so it was kind of my way of experiencing certain things without having to worry about judgment, I guess.
Yeah.
Jesse was also very much more eloquent than me because that was really, really well said about RPGs. But same, I'm not a writer, but I love reading. And I've always loved being able to explore new worlds without having to leave my house.
Are you a diverse, well, maybe both of you, are you diverse gamers, play lots of different kinds of games, or do you stick to these narrative RPG?
I dip a toe into, like...
You play quite a range from what I know, because if you go Dishonored, you played Overwatch. And Baldur's Gate. I think Apex, you have quite the range.
Yeah, I don't know what it is.
You're very RPG, I feel like.
Very RPG, but I do really like Overwatch. There are a few, like, shooter games that I really like, and, like, multiplayer online ones. Like, I used to play... Heroes of the Storm. I used to play World of Warcraft. I used to play... What's the one with Jinx? I can't think of it right now.
With Jinx?
League of Legends.
Yeah.
I tried Dota.
I think those ones are also in the same realm as, like, they have a lot of depth to them as far as, like, the characters.
The lore gets me more than
the game. Exactly. They all have lore. That's what it is.
So, to answer your question, yes, we are diverse, but I think we all kind of tend to more go towards RPGs. Mm-hmm. Yep. I think.
Same.
Just for comfort, I think.
Probably us too. Alyssa and I are probably a little more, well, I don't know you. I don't know anything about you.
Well, I don't know you.
I'm just making statements like we're probably more diverse gamers than they are. Do you think we are?
Stranger in my house.
I feel like, wait, you said they're more diverse than
us? No,
I think we're probably more diverse. I feel like I show them a lot of games, not to brag, but Jesse's played like a lot of the indie games that like Little Miss Fortune, Jesse's played at my place, and
it's a good
I feel
one.
Like,
good
but they've you. Also shown me really good games too.
Oh, and all the horror games that we've played together. Oh. Those are sick as hell.
Oh yeah, I'm showing them the Dark Anthology right now. So like the Quarry, Little Ho, Hope.
Our little nickname for it, Little Ho.
All those games.
Did you guys play Spiritfarer? Did you? You said
yes.
You passed Spiritfarer on.
I did not yet. I'm still working on Legend of Zelda: Tears of the Kingdom. I'm on Sky Island.
Well, that's fine. Yeah, that.
That's a big one. That's a big one.
Yeah, super do that. Yeah. You played Spiritfarer?
It made me cry.
No, we're getting off topic. everybody should go play Spiritfarer, even though that game's good. Like 5 years old now. Probably
it's so good.
Oh shit.
It felt newer.
It does feel new.
Everything feels new to me. I'm aging too fast.
I don't get to things very quickly.
Time is rapid. I'm deteriorating. Help.
Help.
All right, last get to know you question. Besides what you're playing right now, because we're going to super fucking get into that. What was the last game you played?
Like today?
No, just before the game you were playing. I know what you're playing now. We're going to talk about it.
Spiritfarer, actually, oddly enough, yeah.
Did you finish it?
Yes, yes, I did.
Right. Did you do the DLC characters with the bat and the...
Yeah, I didn't even realize they were DLC characters because I played it so late. I thought it was still part of the game.
I thought I didn't... The only reason I found out it was DLC was because I had to look up how to finish their story because I got stuck.
Oh.
Yeah, so then it was like the DLC characters, whatever their names, Barbara and Joe or whatever.
Oh, the bat?
Yeah.
Her story was like, whoa.
Yeah.
One named Barbara?
No. No. Nah, it's a bat.
Dahlia?
Dahlia.
Yeah.
Barbara.
Her like Barbara.
Did the Beach Boys write a song about each character?
Yeah, her like whole like psychedelic break thing was like
so cool.
Whoa.
So cool.
Yeah, it was good.
What about you?
Besides Alan Wake 2, because we'll end up Oh God, now I forgot.
You can say Alan Wake 2.
Okay, that was the most recent one because I played
that
in the middle of.
Let's talk about it right now.
I'm doing
okay.
Let's talk about Alan Wake 2.
She can't wait.
Sid, go ahead.
We're transitioning.
What do you want me to say about it?
Well, I guess,
panicked.
I guess let me set up. So it's winter, right? And Alyssa and I have talked about this on the podcast and over and over and over how much more we play games in the wintertime.
Yeah.
And that didn't necessarily happen, I don't think, for either one of us until after Christmas.
It was around, it was like Christmas, if you call it Christmas break, like when you have off for work between Christmas and New Year's or whatever. Yep. That's when I got really back into it.
Yeah. I think during the holidays, you know, you're like, have all these obligations, so you can't just like sit down and relax. Like, I have to buy presents. I have to see my family.
I have to work hard. I have to make money.
Yeah.
I have to go here.
And after that, it's like, I have time now.
Yeah.
And since then, I've been like super jacked. Like, it's, So I've been playing all kinds of, well, not all kinds of stuff. I've been playing every day more hours for sure.
Yeah.
I was only playing like a couple times a week or.
Yeah. Something. Now it's like all I do. I get home from work and just sit down.
Yep. Instead of making time for other things.
Yeah. So over my Christmas break, I played a lot of Death Stranding 2.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. I forgot you were playing
Not
that one.
Not 2. So over my Christmas break. So over my Christmas break, I played a lot of Death Stranding and I actually beat the game like right after Christmas. And so I put out my first rapid review with Birds and Swords.
Yeah, so new rapid reviews coming. We wanted to do smaller chunks. Plus, I wanted to fit them into like the reels or short videos too, where we could show some gameplay, do the voiceover. So we just released our first one of that. Alyssa reviewed a 5-year-old game.
Yeah, classic me.
Yep, and that's gonna be part of it. So we're gonna do reviews just based on what we're playing right now, and we don't always play brand new things.
Nah,
we love to get recommendations from friends or go back and play things that we missed and just play whatever we're in the mood for.
Check out my review of Pong next week.
Yeah, finally getting back to it. I think your mom's gonna review Punch Out for the NES. You decide if you want to go grab that or not.
Flying off the shelves.
But those are going to be fun, and we're going to play some new things too. So yeah, you did Death Stranding, and I know we've got one. Your next one coming up is going to be Alan Wake 2, so yeah, let's go ahead and jump into that.
Yeah, so Sid and I both played Alan Wake 2. The difference between our playthroughs is that I played the first game, and I'm a diehard Alan Wake fan. So I went into this knowing what to expect and had the bar set very high, and they met my expectations and more. It was just the perfect horror game. It was scary. It was funny. It like was quick-paced, but not confusing. I loved every second of it. Whereas, Sid, you went into it not playing the first one, so this was a brand new experience for you. So I'm curious to know what it was like.
Well, the reason I started playing it is you put a little synopsis in our group chat that it was you're a detective trying to figure out this supernatural mystery. And that's what I was like, oh shit, I need to actually play this. And so that's what actually got me, was just you saying what it was. I had no idea. I knew nothing about the game. I don't play a ton of horror games on my own because I'm usually so far in RPG hell that I don't really have the attention span to play anything else. I just went into it knowing that I was going to like it because I love true crime. So
yeah, that's something they did with the second game, is you don't just play as Alan.
Is it better than the first one?
Yes. It blows it out of the water. Like, I told Sid, don't even play the first one now. It's like, it makes it look like a shit game. Yeah. And I loved the first game. It was amazing.
Well, that was like 15 years ago or
13.
Something. 13?
Yeah.
I love how she knows.
That was so fast. In the second game, they add a character. You don't just play as Alan, which is interesting. I won't get too much into it because I noticed that a lot of the men who play the game don't like the second character, who's a strong, powerful woman, intelligent. And
like an FBI agent?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. But women love her. So they added the second character who essentially, you like do the true crime board with the red string and you like solve the true crime stuff and you're like a true crimer. And it's phenomenal because it's like every true crime fan is living their dream.
You.
Oh, me. Yeah. Yeah.
So good.
Yeah. So they added her whole story into it, so you're not just playing as Alan. And I actually enjoyed her story. I enjoyed her play. I enjoyed her gameplay more, but I enjoyed Alan's story a little bit more. But both were great. It was perfect. It was a perfect game. I loved it.
It's pretty long.
It's about, I put a, probably like 40, 45 hours in.
I was
45, really?
About 3 days.
I was probably pretty close to that.
I played, yeah. Oh. We both beat it in like 3 days. I just like,
that's all you did.
I didn't move the dent in my couch is massive.
Bigger.
Yeah, Zach is making fun of me every day for it.
Aww.
I had a phenomenal horror game.
Yeah. I had been playing Baldur's Gate a little bit before that and then took a break because I was like, okay, I kind of want to spend time on something else a little bit because too much time has been invested in Baldur's Gate at that point. Mm-hmm. Played Alan Wake, only played Alan Wake for a good 3-4 days. And obviously now we're back to Baldur's Gate, which we'll talk about later. But yeah. It's phenomenal. As someone who didn't know anything going into it, it was 10 out of 10. It's probably one of the scariest games I've ever played, and not for jump scares, because I'm not super into jump scare horror games. Like, Dead Space was really mostly just jump scares and then body horror with how disgusting those things were. But this was, like, actually really
creepy.
Cool. Yeah.
Like, it was like the lore was scary.
I had
and like the anxiety.
Dreams about this.
Me
dude.
Too. It was so awesome.
God.
So where does this rank in the echelon of horror games? That's one of your favorite genres. So
God, it's gonna take.
I mean, towards the top. I mean, you can just say towards the top.
It's gonna. I think it's better than Little Nightmares, which is my favorite horror.
Those are very different.
I do love Little Nightmares.
Yeah, but they're both horror, and I just like this game. I like the humor and the horror just mixed in perfectly.
It's so well done. One minute
it's
you're
so
like
funny.
Nearly shitting yourself, and the next you're just laughing.
And sometimes you're shitting and laughing.
like you're you can so shit yourself scared. From being scared and laughing.
Dude,
also,
exactly. It's so good. And I correct myself when we talked about the video game awards a little bit. I mentioned that there was a random musical with Alan Wake. Not random.
It's not random.
Not random.
It's in the game, and it's the best level of any video game I've ever seen. There's a reason that this game won creative direction, and it's that whole level. It's phenomenal. So I can't recommend this game enough. People who haven't played this game aren't my friend.
I'm so sorry.
Go I'm away.
Kidding. I'm just
kidding.
Go.
I'm kidding. Right. I'm being dramatic because I love that game. So, but that yeah. So
it's yeah. It's worth it.
And we'll have a review up for it next week.
Yes, next week for sure.
Okay.
I can review it right now. Perfect.
Well, I say, yeah, be careful with those 10s.
It won't be a 10, but it's going to be pretty dang close.
You can give it a 10 if you want.
No, we'll there's see. Some things.
We'll there's see. Some things. There's always some tings.
Just one thing, really.
Stay tuned. Stay
Other
tuned.
Other than that, it's perfect.
She's like, the only thing that was wrong with it was that it ended.
Yeah, right.
There you go.
I give it a 9.9 because it ended.
I mean, it's still not a 10.
Only because I'm not still playing it.
Right. Oh, yes. So that, yep.
All right, good to hear. I want to play it. I can't like Did you borrow play the first it from one? Anybody. Oh yeah.
Okay. So
it's digital only, right?
So I will say a couple things. If you've played the first one, it elaborates so much on the story of the first one, and there's characters, returning characters. So I had to look up a recap because it's been so long. But there's returning characters. They elaborate on like backstory stuff, and the final level, without spoiling anything, gives an amazing ode to the first game.
Aww.
It's just it's so good.
You think there'll be another one?
Yes.
Without spoiling anything?
Yes. Okay. I think at the very least, they will give us DLC. At the very least.
Oh, they better.
And there's a second ending if you play it again, and I very well will.
Ooh-wee.
I'm sorry, there's... What? There's a second ending.
I'm sorry, what?
It's called the Final Draft. There's so it's more like the new Alan game Wake plus. So you play it again, you get another ending, which I'll probably play in easy mode, because normal is actually really hard.
Do it in easy. Normal's awful.
Me with Bulldog.
What was her name? Cynthia? Was that the old chick?
The one in the...
Stuck on her for so long, floating around, spitting at me.
I texted you, like, I can't beat her. Immediately 3 minutes later, texted you, never mind, I got it. And I had done it like 8 times.
I was stuck on her for a long time. And what... Yeah.
Mm. It's good. Go.
I could talk about this all day, so we should just move on.
Go play it. Let's move on.
Let's talk about what you've been playing, Micah.
Yeah.
As far as what I've been playing, I've been dumping large amounts of hours into Rogue Legacy 2. I think I've talked about the first Rogue Legacy quite a bit.
Yeah.
A couple different
times.
So
when did 2 come out?
It's been out for a minute. It's one of those, it was on PC for a while, and then it got released on Switch exclusively as a timed exclusive for like a year, and then it came to PS5 and Xbox probably over the summer or fall. So the game is probably like 2 or 3 years old.
Okay.
The first one came out in like 2015 or something.
Okay.
So I love Rogues. We haven't mentioned Rogues yet today. It's at least part of your guys' favorite. Have you guys played Hades?
Yeah, right?
Yes.
I thought you have.
Okay.
Yeah.
So Rogue.
Yes. Got it. Yep.
Yep. So you have to start the whole game over every time you die.
That's Cult of Lamb is a rogue. Like?
No.
Is it roguelike?
No.
Oh.
Because like it's like a dying to progress kind of game as a rogue. So Cult of the Lamb is like a base builder dungeon crawler, right?
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And Rogue Legacy and Hades are both roguelites. Because true rogues, you like start over and don't get anything. These games let you put like one more point into health. This run becomes a little easier. So as you keep going through your runs, they get stronger and stronger and stronger. Plus, as you beat bosses, you don't have to beat those bosses again. So in Rogue Legacy, the first game, there's 4 bosses. In the second one, there's 6. Well, there's probably 7. There's probably a master boss after that. But what makes it unique, it's a side-scrolling platformer. I'm old, so I like the old scroll to the right and do the platforming. I would compare the gameplay most to Mega Man, probably. Not all the characters like shoot projectiles or have guns or anything like that. It's kind of medieval, so it's sword and shield kind of stuff. But what's unique about it is each time you die, you play as an heir of the character that just died. So you're playing as their children. So it's a legacy of like your family.
That's and they have cool. traits, which is their traits are hilarious.
Yeah. So they reflect in gameplay mechanics because these children all have specific like personality traits. And I've got some of them pulled up. I know you guys haven't played it. So I'll just read some of these so they can have certain kinds of things. There was one in here about chickens. I've got
I love it.
She's got to know about that one.
It's me. Yeah. I'm the chicken.
And these are like real things. So it's. Man, I don't even know how to pronounce this. Electrororophobia. It says chickens freak you out. So the repercussion is sometimes instead of dropping a chicken leg, which is like the food, like health, to give your character health. So sometimes instead of dropping a chicken leg, a chicken is spawned that runs around and can even damage the hero. Killing this chicken will drop a normal chicken leg and grants the achievement, blah, 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 blah.
Wow.
So that'll happen on that specific run. Wow, you know what I mean?
I love it.
You can have Alzheimer's. You have trouble remembering where you are.
Oh, no.
The map is removed entirely, yet the mini-map still functions normally.
What?
You'll get a look at the map when accessing waypoints, but with no info and little navigation.
That sounds hard.
So specific.
You can be colorblind, so everything's in black. The game's in black and white.
Wild.
There's been, what's that called? Vertigo. The game is upside down.
Oh my God.
So you're like playing on the ceiling.
That would get me.
So each run, and some of those are positive effects, some of those are negative effects. So the negative ones, the things that make the game harder, like there's things where projectiles pass through walls or enemies are censored. Like they look like they're nude or something. You can't tell what kind of enemy it is, so it makes it harder. Oh, so you can get like plus 30% gold.
The one you sent me, it was like anxiety attacks.
Oof.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like all of us.
It's like popcorn is nightmare fuel.
Yeah.
Well, that one sucks because every time you get hit, the screen darkens.
Oh.
And it takes like 2 seconds to like come back.
Oh,
like
my
you can only see your character.
Dang.
No.
It's hard.
So there's all these unique things that really make it a lot of fun.
I love watching you play it. I can't play it, but I love like getting super stoned and watching you play.
Yeah, and it's super hard too, especially when you get late game.
Yeah, like you're really good at it. You're almost done with the second one, right?
Yeah, I'm almost done. I got two biomes left, and there's a real steep difficulty spike right before those two.
Yeah, I believe that.
But the game's so fucking fun, man.
So
it's so fun. It like Hades. I mean, it kind of just throws you right in. You pick your heir, pick your child, or whatever, and just, you're like, oh, I don't want to stop. So let's just keep playing. It's like hard to find a place to stop.
I feel that.
It's one of those ones where you're
definitely
like,
recommend.
One more round.
Yeah. I just got my new character. I'll just do one.
Just do one.
You can have dementia. The player occasionally hears creepy laughter and noises. The player also occasionally sees enemies that don't exist.
Oh no. That's
really tough. Horrible. You can be a dwarf. We saw that.
Yeah, he was so little.
You are adorable.
Yeah,
you that's it. You're adorable. Just small.
The only effect.
Adorable.
But there's certain areas of the game where you can only get in if you're little, though.
Mm.
Oh. There are advantages of it, like a real tight space.
Yeah.
When you run in. It's like being small Mario, kind of.
Mm, yeah.
Mario.
Good times. So I will do the same. I'll have a review up for Rogue Legacy 2. You bet your ass. I'm going to love it. So probably be a pretty good review there. Okay, we need to get into a viral game, Pal World.
Yeah.
We're going to do that right after the break. We're going to have a special phone call from someone who has played that and has more information on it. So we'll dive into Pal World right after this.
You are listening to Micah and Alyssa on Birds and Swords. Please like, subscribe, turn on notifications, and smash that like button.
Thank you to BetterHelp for sponsoring this episode. BetterHelp is the world's largest therapy service, and it's 100% online. With BetterHelp, you can tap into a network of over 25,000 licensed and experienced therapists who can help you with a wide range of issues. To get started, you just answer a few questions about your needs and preferences in therapy. That way, BetterHelp can match you with the right therapist from their network. Then you could talk to your therapist however you feel comfortable, whether it's via text, chat, phone, or video call. You can message your therapist at any time and schedule live sessions when it's convenient for you. If your therapist isn't the right fit for any reason, you can switch to a new therapist at no additional charge. With BetterHelp, you get the same professionalism and quality you expect from in-office therapy, but with a therapist who is custom-picked for you, more scheduling flexibility, and at a more affordable price. Get 10% off your first month at BetterHelp.com/TheBarn. That's BetterHelp, HELP.com/TheBarn.
Welcome back to Birds and Swords 2024. Hey, we've got the Jesse and Sid here. I noticed you guys get along like super well.
Way too well.
They've known each other for like ever.
It seems like years. Well, it has been years. It seems longer.
How long have you guys been hanging out? How long have you been friends?
8 years? 9 years?
It's been like 10, bro.
Oh, fuck me.
You guys lived together for a while, too.
We did, yes.
You got that friendship chemistry, though, all three of you.
She was the first.
Oh, I was adopted, so it's exciting.
I feel like you adopted us.
Oh,
actually, yeah.
And you've all got the eye makeup eyeliner thing. Yeah. What do you call that?
The wings.
The wings.
Wings, that's winged what it's
eyeliner,
called?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Winged eyeliner.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We're all the same font, different weights.
Yes.
Yes. Same font family, different, you know, bold, italics.
Yes.
Did anybody make New Year's resolutions? Do you guys, are you into that?
Get rid of the clothes that don't fit in my dresser.
Oh, yours is so practical.
That's a good one.
That's a good one.
I have still not done it.
You have all year.
I got all year. All year.
That is practical.
Yeah.
Mine is just, mine is kind of lame. Mine is just like a be better person.
Aww. So, like, I don't think you're going to do that because you're like the best person I know. So.
Agreed. You guys hype
me up.
It's going
to be hard.
I just want to be nicer because I can be mean.
Not to people that matter.
That is a good point. She is right.
Maybe a little judgmental. I can be like that.
Yeah, I just want to be nice. People need I don't want to hurt anyone's feelings. I've accidentally hurt a lot of people's feelings in the past without. I just want to be good.
Oh,
I want to be good.
I want to be on Santa's nice list.
Yeah, I want Santa back.
Mine's kind of dumb too. I decided that I'm going to ask people more things instead of Googling things.
Oh, nice.
Weird? Wait, like that. That's good.
Or maybe
that's
it's even annoying, but
no, I like that. That's I feel like, and that builds more connection.
It's not like I'm not going to Google.
You're going to get a lot of fake information though.
And if I know someone who knows a lot about whatever it is, I'm going to ask them
and they're
going
to Google it.
People like to talk about stuff that they like to talk about.
Yeah, ask me about birds.
Yeah. And swords.
You do all the time.
Or Alan Wake.
We were going to change the name of the podcast to Geese and Guns.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Oh my God. You should have, actually.
Yeah. We should do one episode.
We got to do an off episode of Geese and Guns.
Geese and Guns.
We all talk in a southern accent.
Honk.
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 Honk, honk. Yeah, you're a silly goose.
I'll just have a honk button.
Yeah. Perfect.
Yeah. New Year's resolutions. We'll see. We'll see. I think I can keep to mine for sure.
Yeah. I'm going to do my best.
Some people aren't into it. Some people are.
Yeah.
Anyway, all right, video games. Pal World. Let's talk about Pal World because Pal World is like viral right now.
Yeah, like overnight.
If a game goes viral, because that doesn't really happen. Like Pokemon Go, maybe was a viral thing.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. That was kind of a time and place.
Never heard
deal.
Anything.
I had never heard anything about it until Joe mentioned it, and he's like balls deep in it right now.
Yeah.
Who?
My boyfriend Joe.
We've got Joe on the line.
Bring
I
Joe
do,
out.
And my balls are deep.
Nice. So we got Jesse's dude, Joe, who is playing the game since none of us have and don't know a whole lot about it. You know, all we know, Alyssa, is what? Pokemon with guns.
Yeah,
right?
that's all I've heard. Pokemon with guns, and it's better than Pokemon, and Pokemon should take notes.
To go. take notes.
The game has 1.8 million concurrent viewers, almost the same as PUBG Battlegrounds, which is a pretty large game.
Yeah.
Second in Steam's history. So it's literally become, like you guys said, an overnight just anthem for anyone that plays video games. People are playing it if they like Pokemon. People are playing it if they like Valheim, which is a survival game. People are liking it even if they don't like playing video games, just to kind of get in on it. And it really is Pokemon with guns. And then there's a collection aspect where you can collect people. And
people?
Sounds like slavery.
It'll say that it's inhumane. It's like, hey, you probably shouldn't collect people like this. It's inhumane, but I mean, whatever.
It
knows what it is and it understands.
It's survival too, right?
Yeah, so you build up a base, your base gets raided, all of these.
Is it online?
Run in. Yeah, it's online. You can play by yourself or you can run it online. They even have things called dedicated servers where
is
you rent
hard?
A server from basically a business. And they keep the server up and running because no one can play online together unless the server's up. So a dedicated server just allows you access and your group of up to 32 friends to play on this world.
32 friends?
Just,
that's random.
Who has 32 friends?
That's what I'm saying.
I have three and they're all right here.
Right?
Let's run it back to the beginning. So how long has this been available? Like more than a week? Is this something that just dropped out of nowhere and everybody jumped on it?
4 days.
Okay.
I want to say the 19th. Released on Steam and Xbox Game Pass on the 19th. So it's it was a free game through Xbox, and it was, I want to say, $27 on Steam.
You said it was early access, right?
Yeah, it's got to be, right?
Early access, so this isn't even the finished version of it. There's still issues. People are still finding little hot fixes and things that need to be done. But the best part is a lot of people are running their own servers. So even if patches come out, it's not going to really mess with what they're doing. And they can Mod Tools comes out tomorrow, I think. Mm. So there's people that are like changing all of the pals, which is what they're called in the game, to Pokemon, and that guy's getting sued by Nintendo now.
Dude, did you see his tweet? Yes. No. He just tweeted, Nintendo's coming for me.
Oh my god.
They will.
They're like Disney, but for video games.
Well, kind of worse.
Yeah, for sure.
They're scary. Scary.
So, it's been out for 4 days, so what platform are you playing it on? You playing it on PC?
Yeah, I played it on PC.
Okay. So why don't you, now we said Pokemon with guns, right? Can you kind of explain the gameplay in the simplest terms?
Simplest terms, you wake up on an island. They have a fairly easy tutorial. Find shit, build shit, catch shit.
Nice.
So you're just trying to make it so that your little camp can survive. So you have different, like you have deer pals that'll chop wood. You have little penguins that'll water your plants.
Well, this is excited.
That'll plant seeds.
Can you expand on the penguins?
Please go into depth.
The penguins are fat. They wear bow ties.
Yes.
And they flap around and just jiggle.
Perfect. Jiggle. Perfect. So is this like Ark or what?
That's what I was kind of thinking. It sounds like Ark.
Equivalent to Ark.
Is it as hard as Ark? Are people like raiding each other's camps and ruining lives?
So you can start up. So that's the thing, right? Is if you join what would be like a North American server, there's going to be dick bags. There's going to be people that are like fucking with other people's shit and going through.
Yeah.
But if you just play your own, whether it be with your friends or just on your own PC, you can set everything up. So you can set for no raids. You can set for extra XP. You can set all of these things up so the game is exactly what you want to play, as easy as you want to play it.
That's what I would have to do because I don't like people.
I get sad.
Keep that shit to yourself. So, early access games typically, man, I always think back to how bare bones like Overwatch or Apex was. So how do you see this game? Like, are you happy with where it is now? Or do you think that it's going to just keep, I mean, with the player count, like you said, they're going to be dumping all kinds of time and effort into that thing, I would think. What do you think it's going to look like, a year or two from now? Or what could they add?
So that's the big thing, right, is everyone has this looming, what is Nintendo going to do? Because if they were going to do something, it would have been in pre-production. It would have been before release. It would have been when the studio announced that they were going to do this thing, and they didn't. So now it's the what-if process of, like, if this, I mean, it made 1.8. It's bigger than almost any other, like, Pokemon release. It's this massive game, so at what point in time is Nintendo going to be upset about it?
Where's the
line?
And
if that happens, it might take everything off. So that might completely just destroy it through legal battles and bullshit that Nintendo can afford. Or they go, do you know what? Fuck it. Let it breathe. And I think this could be something the map is massive. I've played over 20-something hours. I have friends who have been no-lifing it and have 40-plus hours, and they haven't discovered everything. They haven't gone through the whole map. It's just you have to travel everywhere, and you have to find your fast waypoints, and there's so much space for them to do something. And if they went, hey, do you know what? You've reached level 50, and you've conquered this world. Guess what? We've created another one. They have that capability. They have the endless possibility of doing whatever they want. And with mod tools, that gives the players the ability to do whatever they want. So if they're like, hey, we're actually going to upgrade this and do this like they did with Baldur's Gate 3, the mod tools for Baldur's Gate 3 allowed Baldur's Gate to reach new heights and people be able to really get interactive with it. So it really has the possibility to be anything it wants to be. It's just based on the player base.
Yeah. We don't even know what it'll evolve into.
Yeah.
So do you play as a human?
Yeah, so you play as what looks to be a human. I mean, there's no, it's funny because there is no story, right? You are just on this island, and a tutorial goes, find shit, catch shit, battle these towers that have these people in it. So that might be something that as the game gets produced a little bit more, they add in a story. So you know why you're doing these things or why you're not doing these things or why there's these rebel camps that are capturing these creatures. Or they might just leave that all up to interpretation because the main objective is just to find everything if you can. And then there's five major towers that have a boss pal and a boss person. So they're a combo duo that you have to fight, but you don't really understand why, other than the lore cards that you kind of pick up as you go through the game.
And I could see them adding tons more on that front too, because you could even release like digital shorts or some other kind of media,
like how Overwatch does the shorts.
Exactly. Yeah,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, do you feel like do you think this is like healthy for Nintendo to look at and like in a competitive way? Like, do you think that they're going to be like, oh shit, look how great this game is doing, we should do better? Because I feel like Pokemon has been re-releasing the same fucking game for the past 20 years.
Yeah.
So
that was my biggest thing, was exactly what you said, Nintendo coming back at it over and over.
Because they haven't done anything yet. So like, maybe they'll just be like, let's do better.
Let's do something different.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The fans are upset. They're like, how could you rip off Pokemon?
Everything rips off Pokemon.
Everything
rips off Digimon.
Everything rips off everything.
It is what it is.
Yeah.
But this is like, people love this. Mm-hmm. People didn't necessarily love the last 17 Pokemon because they were all kind of the same.
Right.
I will say, when I saw you when I saw you playing it for a little bit, I was really surprised at the graphics. I was like, this looks really good for a game that's supposedly ripping off Pokemon. I was like, damn, nice.
So what are the Pokemon called?
Made it on Unreal Engine 5, so
that
makes sense.
Oh yeah. Yeah, I bet it's gorgeous.
It's in 4K, it has all the shaders. And Pokemon runs at a top of 1080p, so you're maybe throwing the difference between a PS5 and a PS2,
right?
At like 24 frames per second,
exactly. And a $60 game of Pokemon or a $26 game of this.
Oh, nice!
It's one of those things. If you have the ability,
it's like, wait a minute.
I will say that from what I've seen, it does look like a direct ripoff of Pokemon. Like, they look like the same creatures, but like Sheen or Teemu. Yeah. But I mean, like, get it if it's,
get it.
You know? Honestly, I ain't mad about it.
Yeah, it's blowing up. TikTok it.
Yeah,
TikTok. I'm sure there's a zillion already. Yeah. What are they called? Pokemon? They're obviously not called.
No, they're called pals.
Pals.
Pals. P-A-L.
Just pals. My good old pal.
Pals.
And same kind of drill. Yeah, like they all have types and like elements.
So the water type. You're built up with your water, your ice, your dragon, your dark, your light.
It's just the same.
The thing that's really cool. The same.
Ghost. Yeah.
Ghost. It's actually dark on here.
Dark.
Oh.
Because they only come out at night. So that's why they have dark, because they're not all ghost types.
Oh.
It's a dark type in Pokemon.
But you can only find them at night because they just disappear once. It has a full 24-hour clock on it.
Yeah.
So once the night time hits, the pals kind of refresh and change.
Almost like Minecraft a little bit.
Well, it sounds like it's not just the guns part. Like, it sounds like the whole game being like the open world kind of arc. Kind of
people are just shook
up
by the guns.
Yeah,
people are shook by the guns.
People are shook by the guns.
You can grab a Vulpix and squeeze its stomach and make it a flamethrower. People are like, oh, guns for sure.
Wow.
Get on it.
Valid.
Wow, that's crazy.
Do you stream or anything?
No, I don't stream.
You used to.
I haven't in like 2 years, but thoroughly enjoyed.
He's busy serving our country.
Oh yeah, he's in the Navy, Marines, Navy ish.
I was gonna say Army, and I was way off. So
nope,
not that.
Oh no.
He's like, oh god, no.
If we're gonna say it, we'll say Navy.
Navy, valid. Okay, cool.
All right, so it's Pal World. Go play it. It's available on PC and Xbox for the moment. I know the other systems are crying for it. So super popular right now. So hopefully we can get around to checking that out. Well, I know Zach's gonna.
Yeah.
Zach's
He probably doesn't know about it yet because he's never on Facebook and stuff. Once he catches wind that his life is ruined.
Ruined.
It's, yep.
I'm going to send you right now.
That's happening.
Yeah, do it. Do it. Do it. Do it. Do it. Do it.
All right. Thanks for the time, Joe. Pal World, available now. Go play it. Thanks, Joe.
Yeah, thank you, Joe. Have a good one, guys.
Bye.
Bye.
That was Joe with Pal World. We're going to take one more break, and then we're going to come back, and Baldur's Gate is going to dominate this shit, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
We are brought to you by www.betterhelp.com/thebarn, Healthy Hemp Gear, and Black Bayou Coffee Roasters. We'll be back right after this.
Woo!
This is Michaela Jade. I make video games, and you're listening to Birds and Swords.
Looking to add to your outfit or home in a sustainable way? Look no further than Healthy Hemp Gear, now partnered with Birds and Swords to bring you even closer to perfect solutions for your day-to-day life. Use code BNS, that's B&S, to get 15% off each order of hemp apparel and home goods, just for being an awesome listener. Go to healthyhempgear.com today to check out apparel that appreciates the earth and you.
We are back with Birds and Swords. I've got an audio for this last segment because just like the VGAs, Baldur's Gate's about to take over.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty epic. It's pretty epic.
So epic.
Super epic.
It like doesn't match what you've told me about the horny
it is. It's so serious yet so silly.
But Baldur's Gate 3 just came out this past fall. All three of you guys are playing it, right?
Yeah.
So three out of four of the panel are playing Baldur's Gate. So Alyssa, tell us everything we need to know about this 300-hour game.
Okay, so let me preface that this is basically a Dungeons and Dragons game, and I've never played Dungeons and Dragons, so I'll give you the best rundown that I can. Essentially, you play through a Dungeons and Dragons campaign. So you roll virtual dice, you make decisions, you battle, and everything is based off of your probability and your dice rolls. Even in battle, you're rolling dice without like choosing to, like it just kind of does it for you for each hit, for like it'll show you the probability of hitting them, the probability of dodging them, like everything is dice, and you're playing through this campaign. There's just 100 million different ways the story can go. You start off by designing your own character all the way down to the genitals. So, and I did choose vagina because I know that best. so
you customize
this panel does.
Yes.
You customize the vagina?
Yes.
How so?
The hair mostly. Okay. Yeah. So how chopped you are. Okay. So Baldi's Gate. So
but if you have a penis, can you change the not it's not just hair, I would hope, right?
I think it's the shape a little, right? There's like three penis options.
Yeah.
Three,
wow.
Length and girth.
I don't remember because
I didn't look at the penises.
None of us have that equipment.
Usually scare me a little.
Sorry, the vagina's a little bit easier to take.
I'm safe around the vagina, so I kind of just stuck to what I know.
What I know.
So I didn't look at the penis too much.
Took a little gander.
And I was like, whoa. So, but it's very
full customization.
But not the boobs, which is a little offensive.
That was weird.
Yeah, because how can I customize my vagina but not my boobs?
Like, come on.
So
wow, that's
I know, because I'm a big titty girl, and I wanted to have a big titty girl on screen. But I actually started one playthrough and hated my character because I have this thing where I try to make them look like me, but then because I have like main character complex, so I'm like, they gotta look like me. I'm the main character, but then I resent them because they look like me, and I think I'm ugly.
Interesting.
So then I hated my character and had to make a new.
Man, you're like on the couch right now. Like, yeah. Tell us more.
Tell us more.
How does this trouble?
So, it all stems back to when I was bullied.
Oh no.
So anyway, so you totally create this character, the race, the class. You pick kind of your dice qualities. What would that be?
Oh, your stats.
Stats.
Like constitution, dexterity, strength, and all that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then as you progress through the game, you encounter characters that can join your main party if you do the right things to get them to join, which I have fucked up.
How many people can you have in your party at a time?
Four, like three plus you, so four total.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So
there's like a group dynamic there, and they have dialogue with each other.
They interact. They can fuck each other too.
They can, which apparently. I didn't know.
So this is the horniest game I've ever played.
It's so horny.
I knew we'd get here. We're here already.
So let me continue about the story first, because basically you start the game on like this alien. It's called Mind Flayer ship, and they put a bug in your eye, and it parasites into your brain, and you escape the ship and with other people that have the parasite brain, and you come across other people who have the parasite brain, and you spend the whole game trying to figure out how to get this thing out of your brain, because it will turn you into these alien mind flayer things, and you'll just like fuck shit up if you do that. You'd like totally lose yourself. So the whole point is you just go from act one to two to three to get to Baldur's Gate, your journey there, and you come across all sorts of crazy shit on the way to get this thing out of your brain. So that's the plot.
Is it on the Earth?
It's on Furon?
Faerun.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Faerun.
Okay.
So no.
Good, I hate it here.
But you...
One developer in a meeting just said that, and they're like, fine, yeah. This is going to happen elsewhere.
Good.
Not here.
No, that's in the Skyrim realm.
Yeah, none of that.
It is the horniest game I've ever played because, like, for example... You can fuck everyone.
Yes.
In your party, outside of your party.
Multiple people at one time.
I walked in on an ogre and an orc having sex.
In a barn.
In a barn.
Don't forget that.
Okay, so does this happen through dialogue?
Mostly, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, like one of the characters, Lazelle, everyone wants to wife up somebody in the game.
Mm-hmm.
And if you wipe, like, you have to be careful because some of them are okay with like threesomes and poly and all that. Some aren't. And I'm trying to wife up Gale, and Lazelle keeps trying to climb me
like a tree.
And she's not unattractive. And I had to turn her down three times, and she keeps telling me how much I'm going to regret it. She's kind of thinking about it at night.
Thinking about it.
And then my other wife, I got her murdered. Bad. She got murdered so bad. So now I'm a little lonely.
No.
Is every character open to the entire spectrum?
I think so.
There's no like gender preferences.
Yeah.
No.
You can be as gay as you want.
Which is the goal. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
You can do a lot of that in Dragon Age.
Yes.
But only certain characters can be gay or
or whatever. Doesn't matter who you are.
Or some are bisexual, but it all depends on the character.
Mm-hmm.
But
for this, it only really depends on like who you are as a person. Like if you insult your choices. People a lot, Asterion will be like, oh, let's fuck.
Yeah.
You have to be good to romance Karlach. She's like lawful good, which is extremely hard in that game.
So does the Sexton have to do on a dice roll then?
Yes.
Yeah.
With Gale. Fuck.
Really?
Oh, God. Fuck that.
That's right. The magic. Yeah.
Doing that in real life.
Wait, I got a fucking nat one. Where's the hole? Like,
not to get too personal, but like, Zach's like, I'm in the mood, and you're like, roll the dice, bitch.
Actually, do it.
Like, roll the dice, bitch.
Do it. Critical failure.
Oh, no.
Could you imagine?
That's oh, nice. Yeah.
Yeah.
So the romance is not a huge part of the game, but it feels like a huge part of the game.
When you're a fan, it is like, I feel like that's all I saw on like social media before I started playing was like, ah, who are you wifing up? And it's like memes about like Karlach.
When I typed in Baldur's Gate 3, the first prompt was threesome? Question mark.
Baldur's Gate threesome. It's a common misconception. It's not three. It's threesome.
It is the horniest game ever. It really is. The characters, like the playable character, the joinable characters, companions, your party, the companions, they can have sex with each other and they can have sex with you. And
there's also a whole other like character that you design also when you like your guardian.
Oh yeah.
I made her too hot.
She's so hot. Yeah, no, I made her too hot too.
And she doesn't wear a bra. Who did that?
Who did you? We all did that.
I made her my type, and I'm mad about it.
So this sounds like a huge part of why you play the game.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh yeah. 100%.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
It's so gay.
It's the gayest.
There's everybody's hot.
We're all in. It's relatively a problem. Straight relationships.
I make myself hot, and I can fuck everything.
I know.
So that's not. Let's move on.
Because we'll come back to it.
That is an awesome. That well, actually, let's go through for our viewers who we're romancing mainly. Jesse.
So for my character, I originally wanted to romance Asterion because when I played the game, I was like, oh, he's so fucking hot. But when I made my character, she's like this very like, I picked the sage background. So she's very like rogue, but bookish. And she loves like stealth, but also knowledge. And so that really vibed with Shadowheart just through like the choices that I made. And so when I went through her story, it just felt really right. So now I'm in love with her. And
Shadowheart fits you though.
I
like,
will never do anything
bitch.
To make her mad.
Yeah.
And she gets mad.
Yeah. That's like your type.
Yeah.
Are you thinking about it right now?
I'm thinking about it right now.
Yeah. Always thinking
And she
about
goes
her.
Through a really like, big change in the I won't say anything, but like she's got a real big choice to make, and it's really central to her character. Like I just think she's really cool.
She is so frustrated with me. I could never romance her.
No.
But I'm not super into her. I think she's kind of whiny for me.
That's the thing. It's like when you play, it really does matter the choices you make and how you play the game, because different companions will vibe with different choices.
Yeah.
So I wasn't originally gonna do it, but then it just happened.
Sid.
Initially, I also wanted Asterion because, come on now, he's white-haired elf boy. I love him. Yeah, he's 10 out of 10.
Pale guy.
But then I met Karlach.
Everyone's favorite mom.
And dear God, this woman could punch me in the face and I would say thank you.
Step on me.
Oh my God, she's so good. But she's so lawful. And like I said earlier, I'm realizing I would not be that way in the world.
She's
always like, I
want to
help everybody. And I would be like,
I love that about her though. She like breaks the stereotype of like big and want to smash.
Yes. Yeah. Yep.
Like she does. But
she's
like,
soft.
With love.
How do you spell that?
Karlach. I'm impressed I did that without writing it down.
Good job. Understand. Yeah, I like Karlach a lot. I mean, it's easy to impress her, just like be against slavery, really.
That's what I said. Yeah, mommy doesn't like slavery.
You gotta be nice to people. Yeah. She's a tiefling infernal. She's been through a lot of shit.
She's so happy.
She's got like one horn.
Yeah, it got cut off, I think, in a fight or during battle when she was battling in the hells. She's 10 out of 10. I love her. Yeah. I did not expect
to
romance
her. She's
such
an optimistic being for her
size.
Yes.
Yeah.
It just makes her so lovable.
And I didn't expect to like her as much as I did. And then I met her and I was like,
that's why
I would die for you.
The characters are so deep.
Yeah. They're so well written.
Many layers.
I stick to my type. The long-haired, funny boy, nerdy Gale.
Mm-hmm.
He's the wizard. He's and well, I almost went for Halzen because he's hotter. But Gale is funny. And I'm
He's got like this.
He's charming.
Yeah, he's so charming. I love him. He's my wifey.
And also, he fucked a goddess, so you know he knows what he's doing.
I know. I know. I was like,
he looks like he was plucked out of Lord of the Rings.
Yeah.
Oh my god. Yes, he does.
That's a good point.
He's like a nice.
Now look up
Halzen.
Halsin. That's my second daddy.
God, I love that man so much.
I just...
When I found him, I was like...
hang off his biceps.
Oh, he's like buff elf guy.
Yeah.
Let's not forget about the one that got away, though.
Stop.
Stop.
Jahira.
I would have left them all for Jahira, and I got her murdered.
It's so easy to get her murdered, she's though, in that one fight.
I would have loved her so deeply.
Mm-hmm.
So here's the thing about my playthrough. First of all, let me talk about Dungeons & Dragons. Since I never played Dungeons & Dragons, Jesse, who has played, had to come over to my house and explain how this game works.
It's not straightforward.
Yeah. They're like, use the toggle to move. Goodbye.
Pretty much.
Like, that was the tutorial.
Fucking
yeah. There's a lot of things a lot of details they don't tell you that you kind of have to figure out.
Yeah. So Jesse has come over several times. We actually, on this past Sunday, Sid and I played both of our playthroughs on TVs, and Jesse helped us each because she understands Dungeons & Dragons. And, like, for example... I was stuck on this puzzle for so long because I kept detonating a trap, and I was like, I don't have enough trap disarm kits. I don't know what to do. And Jesse was like, can't you jump over it?
And
you can just jump over it.
Jump over
I mean, it's so, the game makes you feel like a fucking idiot.
It does.
Yeah,
it made me feel stupid.
Yeah.
Jump over it, not an option?
It is an option.
You just don't think of some of the things. Yeah. It's like you don't have to face everything head on. Like, as a rogue, I didn't go through the main entrance of anything. So, like,
that's so different.
You don't
completely different. You can like, do. Because her as a rogue versus me as a monk, I'm just punching my way through everything.
Mm-hmm.
But she has, like, she misses a lot of dialogue because she sneaks and kills.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Whereas I confront and I have a totally different
plot.
That's
how I would play it, though.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't like confrontation as a person or as a character, but there is no door that you can keep me out of.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. I mean, I am accidentally having like an evil playthrough because my decisions are so bad. I'm getting everyone killed. So like, I don't even have merchants to buy from.
So what do you mean by everyone? Like your companions?
Everyone. Sometimes. Innocents, merchants, companions.
The squirrel.
The squirrel lived.
Oh, good. Mm-hmm.
Squirrel lived.
Blue Jay got his nest. Well, it wasn't his nest.
Yeah,
but
that was fucked up. I feel manipulated by that Blue Jay.
Yeah.
So you can talk to animals and they can give you quests. Yeah, and
tell us about, are there birds?
Yes. So
there are so many.
Bird fans. We have several birds in this game that you can talk to. Blue Jays being a big part of it. Please, everyone, remember, this is true bird fact. Blue Jays are very manipulative and they steal birds' nests.
They do.
So whatever they tell you, don't fall for it.
Mm. Those eagles never stood a chance.
Why would I believe that was a Blue Jay nest? It was bigger than me. So anyway.
Those eagles were big though.
You use animal speak and you can talk to animals, but the birds are the best part because the birds have so much drama.
Mm-hmm.
They're fighting with each other. They want you to help resolve their shit. So
they're not just stupid like in Disney movies.
No, they're very intelligent. They have British accents.
What the Blue Jay was like? He had a Cockney accent.
Yeah,
right?
He was Cockney.
Like those dang eagles.
Yeah.
I did not get to this point yet. I didn't know they had accents.
The crush.
Oh yeah, I didn't go there yet. I'm too.
You should
scared.
Do the crush before you do Moonrise Towers. Yes. I read that online. Otherwise, you won't be able to do
Please
it.
Please be very careful in the crush.
I'm just
the crush
scared.
Is where I was stuck when you were over that one day, yeah. And I did the battle like 80 times. So make sure that you're ready to go for that.
I can never go back.
But it is a really good story.
Everything in that game scares the crap out of me, so I'm very much behind, even though I played about as long as Jesse.
Well, and that's
longer
thing,
than Jesse.
You can play several times, like my boyfriend Joe, who we already had on this channel. He's already played through twice, and there are some things that I mentioned to him that he's even like, oh, I never encountered that. And like, just based on where you go, when you go, and what you do, there's like so many different pathways in this game and different options that you can make, and sometimes you won't even see someone.
Just getting to the Underdark, right? Everybody was like, everybody got to the Underdark, like the Act 2 part of the game, a different way.
Mm-hmm.
And my way was, I saved these dudes from these wild things, and they were like, go to this tavern, but the tavern was burnt down, but I found a guy in the tavern, he was like, oh, go behind the wardrobe. And I went behind the wardrobe and found a secret pathway.
That's what I did too.
Yeah, and I like, was in the, I went to the goblin camp, and I, as a rogue, I was like, I can't kill all these goblins right away, I want to pick them off one by one. But then I went into this one room and there was a stairway, and I was like, oh, okay, I'm gonna go down the stairway. And I was in this like temple in the Underdark, and I'm like, what, where am I?
I went back to finish killing the goblins because I have murdered everyone in this game, so the goblins were not gonna stand a chance.
That's fair.
Yeah,
they even mentioned it too when I got to the Underdark. They're like, she killed every goblin, every goblin died.
The goblin slayer.
Do you feel like you're getting more resistance because of the way you're playing?
Yeah, because I can't even buy from merchants because they all got
They're
murdered.
Gone. Yeah.
So I'm having a really hard time, and I killed my wife on accident. So
it's okay, you got another one.
Gail's second best. I would have left him for Jahira so fast. It's just crazy because these decisions keep me up at night.
They do.
I've been thinking about Jahira, what we could have had.
Do another playthrough.
Well, I was going to ask you guys if, like, thanks for coming, right? Mm-hmm. But do you kind of, just a little part of you, wish you were at home playing Baldur's Gate?
Oh, 100%.
Yeah. A bit. Sorry.
Me too.
Yeah. I miss my wife.
Yeah.
That kind of impact.
It's so good.
We're all going to do a playthrough after our own individual one, so that's going to be...
Yeah, that's going to be chaotic.
It's going to be so much.
We're all going to be the camp wiping up everybody.
Yeah! Like, no, I want to fuck her.
So what's the gameplay like? You move your character...
True turn-based.
In a world.
Yes.
And have encounters. When you're not in combat.
So it's a lot... It's like adventure, dungeon crawler, but true turn-based. Like, mm-hmm. True turn-based. So, like, think back, like, Final Fantasy VII.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Like, it's... True turn-based.
Yeah, when you're not in combat, you are free to move your character around like as you will, and it's open world, and there's a lot of stuff to discover. But as soon as you get into any sort of encounter, whether hostile or you have a dialogue option and you fuck it up and then they start attacking you, then it turns into turn-based and you have your initiative rolls, and that depends on who goes first and all that. And there's reactions and dice rolls, like Alyssa said before, and everything you would have in a true turn-based D&D combat.
That's another thing.
You can still, like, run away or...
Oh, yeah. I found this out. If your characters dash enough times in a row, far and away enough, you have the option to flee combat for each one of your characters that does it. And so you can all just go back to camp.
Oh, no. Yeah.
I've done that a couple of times where I was like, I'm going to die.
What's interesting, too, is you can avoid combat almost completely by rolling high enough in dialogue.
Oh,
so
yeah.
Yep. There is one part, I won't get into spoilers, but there's one part where... I had to fight through like 10 really hard creatures because I can't roll high for shit on anything. But Jessie not only rolled high enough that she didn't have to fight them, but they like murdered each other and then themselves.
They did. Yeah.
You can almost completely avoid combat just by rolling high enough in conversation, which never happens to me.
Right. Yeah.
And then I murder them, and then something goes so horribly wrong that the innocents get murdered, and then one of my companions get murdered, and then the merchant gets murdered, and then some animal nearby, an innocent child.
And then you splatter.
Yeah. You can't buy any more trapped as I'm kids. You're fucked.
One merchant, and it's in the grove.
Oh yeah,
it's the only one I got.
What's character development like? Leveling up or acquiring skills?
It takes a very long time to level up.
Yep.
It takes forever, but you get experience points from not only battle, but like discoveries, like dungeons, exploration, conversation, dialogue,
quests. Literally everything.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So you don't have to battle to get experience. But when you level up, it is what I imagine Dungeons and Dragons to be, where you get new, like, leveled up moves, new spells, more hit points, higher rolls, or stats, or whatever.
Yeah.
So...
And you can kind of pick and choose your way through how you want to play. Like, for me, I know that as a rogue, you get a lot of sleight of hand bonuses, and you also get to pick a lot of proficiencies with certain things. So I was like, well, I'm a rogue, so I'm probably going to lie and steal a lot. So I picked a lot of persuasion and deception points, and I kind of, that's the reason that I don't have to deal with as much combat. But
yeah,
that's so funny.
It depends on how you want to go about the game.
Yeah.
I chose rogue simply so I could break into things. I play like a tank otherwise. It's literally, I just want to lockpick everything.
Mm.
I picked monk so I'd be good in combat, and I'm still bad.
I will say, where you are right now, like, there is a portion of the game where I also, like, I screamed because I was having such a hard time, and so you are kind of where I am.
I have not rage quit a game in a very long time, but this game has made me rage quit several times.
But you keep coming back.
But it's
for deny.
Yeah. Sometimes I feel like I'm not having fun, and then I set it down, I'm like, no, this
back.
Is fun.
Yeah.
Keep thinking about it every waking second.
I literally, I can't stop thinking about it.
I really tried to do a genuine playthrough where I didn't load my save, but after I lost Jahira, I stopped.
It was all over from
that
there.
Because then I also lost Karlak's quest because Yemen dies.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Everything you do makes a difference. Everyone's playthrough is so different, which makes it really fun to talk about with your friends.
Yes.
Like when Jessie comes over and watches me play and she's like, I had no idea this could happen.
Yeah.
Like, it's just the way it can just spiderweb.
It literally is all up to just your imagination, honestly. Like, oh, I want to do this. Can I do that? Yes, you can.
Can I put my dick in it? Yes, I can.
Yes, you can.
Oh. So how close do you feel your character where it is now is compared to what you like set out to do? You know what I mean? Like how your character would form? Are you playing totally different than you thought you would? Or are you on the path where when you started, you were like, I'm going to be...
I thought I was going to be a hero and everyone's dead. So it's not for me.
Not going great?
Yeah, I thought, because I picked monks. So I was like, peace, everyone's going to live.
Yeah. Oh.
And everyone is dying. I can't save a single soul in this game. So not for me.
Yeah, I feel like I'm pretty similar as far as like, what do you call that? Your alignment. Like, I'm kind of like a... chaotic neutral,
yes,
a little,
you are.
Yeah, but also like a soft chaotic neutral, because like less chaotic, more like as long as you don't know what I'm doing, it's fine.
Yeah,
like yeah. I just get away with a lot of shit, but I'm also like to people's faces, I'm nice and I do the right thing, and that's a rogue.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah,
I'm too good for what I wanted to do. I wish I was not. It's mostly the person I romanced, to be
honest, and that has a big impact.
So desperate for her approval.
I spent so long just so insecure because Gale was not romancing
me. He didn't reciprocate anything.
And then all of a sudden I murdered all those nuns and he was like, you look so hot with that blood on your face. And I was like, I was like, I knew it. You love me.
It really depends on who you choose to romance to. Because if you choose Astarion, you'd have to be a little bit more self-centered. And
or murder.
Not in a bad way. Or murder. Or both.
He likes me because accidental. Murder everywhere. Yeah.
He likes me as soon as I like pick a lock. He's like, oh, I'm hot.
That's so funny.
Will likes me just because he's good, and so is Karlach, and so they're both like approving of everything I do. And I'm always like,
I always forget about Will.
I'll help you too.
The game forgets about Will.
The game totally forgets.
I also
about
feel
Will.
So bad having to turn people down because he was like dancing and he was like,
oh, he was so nice.
And I was like, I'll dance with you, but don't kiss me.
No, I turned away too because I was like, my heart belongs to another.
I will say,
I think we all did.
Yeah. I was surprised at who Shadowheart did let me bang.
Oh yeah, wait, that's right.
An actual devil. Yeah. Yeah.
So what's your body count?
For
those.
I got no
you
one
both
yet.
Have zero?
I'm working not that on far Gale. Yet. Cause I feel like Lazelle tried to fuck me 3 times. Every time I murder a bunch of people, she gets on me.
Really?
Yeah.
She's hot and bothered.
She's all about the combat. Will tried to kiss me, but he does that to everyone. Mm-hmm. Poor soul.
Poor soul.
And then...
Halzen's on you as soon as you save the Grove.
Yeah, Halzen, and I actually did try with him, but he was like, another time.
Oh,
now
that's me too.
And now that Gale's romancing me, I'm afraid that if I have sex with Halzen, Gale will be like, why would you do that? Even though he's fucking a goddess. So I'm like, I'm just worried. I just don't want to overstep my boundaries.
It's wild. It's so realistic. It's like, oh man, I just can't sleep with anyone I want.
I just want to ask Gale, what are we?
What are we? What are we, Gale?
What are we?
It doesn't have that dialogue option?
No.
It does not, unfortunately.
It has everything.
It kind of does with Shadowheart.
Yeah.
Shadowheart tried to romance me too. Everyone tried to romance me except Gale.
I also think the reason I love Shadowheart so much is she's so very upfront. She's like, I feel this way. Do you feel this way? And I'm like, you got some major balls on you, girl. Yeah. Like,
she was the first person to fall in love with me, and it broke my heart to be like, oh, I want to be with Astarion so bad. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But I love you too, Shadowheart.
Wish I could have you all.
I know. I want them all. So anyway, Dungeons and Dragons dating simulators.
That's honestly all it is.
It feels like one big dating sim for sure.
Yeah, with some added fun in between,
and some lore.
Mm-hmm. Some lore. We all love the lore. I will say a lot of it. It's really cool as someone who has played D&D a couple times and seeing all of the stuff that I already kind of know about. It's like, oh, it's like Leonardo DiCaprio pointing at the TV. It's like, oh, I know what that is.
Yeah.
Like the displacer beast, seeing the mind flares and all that shit is like, oh, it's like, it is really a treat when you have played D&D to see all of the stuff that you've heard about, played about, written about, blah, 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 come to life. That's one thing that I really like about it is the familiarity.
It is cool. And I think a lot of people are probably having that reaction.
Mm-hmm.
It's funny because all three of us have varying degrees of D&D experience. Like Alyssa, you have none. Jesse's played a lot, and I have started campaigns that have not gone anywhere, so I know very little about the game.
Tragedy
except for
of
character building. Oh, dude, I know. And then COVID and everything hit.
Yeah.
So it's interesting because I know a lot about stuff, and I've seen the D&D movie, and I watch Vox Machina, and I'm like a huge fucking nerd about all this shit.
Mm-hmm.
But it's cool to see it in action and not have to be stressed out about actually physically doing all of it, because I have a hard time doing it on the spot if, you know, we're in a campaign in person.
It is nice you can sit on the dialogue options for a little bit.
Yeah, it's not just constant like, oh god, I'm panicking now, I have to make a decision right this second. So I like that about it a lot,
and you're able to load your saves.
Yeah.
Oh my god. Yeah. Like, especially when you fuck up.
I regret that decision.
I'm so sorry. I hurt you. Let me do that.
We're like, this battle went horribly wrong. Yep. Let's try that again.
Yeah. A lot.
Way more than I should.
I didn't until very recently when I lost this beautiful, gorgeous woman to battle. And I didn't load the save and I continued the game and it kept me up at night. And I was like, I'm not making that mistake again.
I feel that. Like, I am such a completionist with every game. So, like, it's impossible to do with this game, but I wanted to do every single thing that you can do in this game. You can't.
Yeah.
But I'm doing my darndest. And if I forget to do something, I'm going to reload that save and I'm going to try something else.
Yeah. And sometimes I just try stuff to see what would have happened.
Exactly.
Yeah. But I don't save just because there's some crazy.
You just want to see more.
Yeah. There's some crazy shit that can happen.
Mm-hmm.
And like, I will not spoil, but because when I was doing my genuine playthrough and you're in the creche and you have to make some very difficult decisions.
Oh, very difficult.
I was sweating.
It's a dangerous place.
I was sweating.
Mm-hmm.
Like, some of the decisions you make are so difficult.
like you paused it, got up, paced
there
around.
There is no pause.
Cigarette.
I mean,
you can sit on the dialogue.
You can't
pause during the cutscenes, which I wish was an option. Yeah. Sometimes people are talking. And
yeah. You have to reload the dialogue, but
there goes the perfect 10 score right there.
Yeah, honestly, yeah. I guess we could kind of go around and rate it, but I would give it like a 9 out of 10. Where it loses points for me is that it does kind of close out the people who haven't played Dungeons and Dragons. Like, if you, like, there's no Dungeons and Dragons tutorial, there's no back lore for you to learn. They don't try to help you if you don't know.
Yeah.
So it is really like a fucking good luck.
yeah. I would agree with that rating. I think I would also give it a 9 out of 10 with the same problem being that, like, if you haven't played D&D, you're going to look a lot of shit up.
Yeah. Same. Kind of similar. I don't know if any of you have played World of Warcraft, but in the beginning of that, sometimes some of the races don't give you anything. Like, I think I remember I started Draenei, so Alliance, didn't tell me anything about how to play the game. It just went, here you go. You're this space horse. And Baldur's Gate kind of feels similar. Where it's like Baldur's gay, where it feels similar that they're just like, okay, here's your basics. Good luck. Have fun. Enjoy trying to memorize all this shit. Like, it's a lot, it's worth it if you're stubborn enough to learn it.
Yes, and if you have someone that's played that can help you.
Yes.
Other than that, it feels like way ahead of its time. Like, this does not feel like it feels like a 2027 game.
It feels like there's way too much detail for this
my system shouldn't be running it.
Right. Like, it's like insane how expansive the world is, and like the AI for the characters is incredible. Like and the facial expressions are real without being uncanny valley. It's so good.
The thing that I liked about it is they brought in things that aren't necessarily even in the game itself. Like, I don't know if you guys have ever read the Forgotten Realms series with Driss Doerden. It's all about this one specific dark elf named Drist, the series wasn't even supposed to be about him, and people loved him so much that they made his backstory, and they actually talk about that. Like, I have these gauntlets of his, and I'm not kidding you, when I looked at Austin, I found these, read the description, and went, Austin,
oh, and Baldur's,
it's Drist Doerden. I know, I was like, my husband Drist, I have his gloves. And he was like, okay, what are you talking about? So, like, if you know a little bit, it's super fun, and even if you don't,
there's a lot of Easter eggs for
that's the cool thing to me, is there's so much there, because I don't think you even knew about those gloves or anything.
No, I didn't. And there was a sword that you had that I was like, wow.
I made it.
Yeah,
and you're like, how'd you do that?
And I was made that shit.
I made this.
Yeah, and I was like,
I don't know how.
I know where you're talking about.
I just kept throwing things into the furnace and it gave me the sword.
Yeah, I didn't end up doing that because there was a part of it that I...
Oh, you had to fight the guy.
Yeah, I did not want to do that.
And I fight everything.
I sometimes avoid
that.
Conflict.
I like literally... There's like this one guy in the the Shadowlands where I rolled so high that he left me alone, and then I attacked him.
I think I know who you're talking about.
Spider Boy.
Every 5 seconds I watch you play that game, you're like, I didn't want to fight, gets in another fight immediately after. You're like, why am I dying? I just got out of a fight. Like, you just entered another fight. What do you mean?
Yeah.
So you guys is everybody in act two?
You're in Act Three. Yeah. Jesse's Act Three.
I'm in the Balder of Gates.
Okay. Sid and I are very close. I'm a little bit ahead of Sid.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So you guys have talked about it quite a bit.
Extensively, yes. Every hour.
All day, every day.
We should chat. See the group chat.
Yeah. It's bad. Nothing about romance.
Specific Baldur's Gate group chat.
No, we should make one.
It is now.
Everybody that doesn't play the game in that chat is so annoyed by
it. I probably just muted it. My boyfriend's definitely muted it, even though he's played it twice.
Well, my question is, based on you guys talking about it all the time and knowing each other so well, I mentioned that earlier, are all of your characters based on what you thought it was going to be? Like, who you thought they would play as? That type of
character? Well, Alyssa does look like Alyssa.
Not looks, but like her choices.
Oh,
if you guys have played
that tracks.
Bunch,
yeah, I think everybody tracks. Everybody's... I think Kai is the way you guys play, because you're trying to impress mommy, and that tracks. And you're so chaotic.
And I love that hot stealthy. Goth girl.
you're intelligent and good at it, and stealthy, and that tracks.
Oh,
and you are like chaotic and impressing mommy.
I'm trying. I'm trying. My damnedest.
And I'm punching things.
Yeah.
So that probably tracks.
I will say also one other thing that we all did the same that I thought was hilarious, because we all are kind of the same person. We all picked the same voice.
Oh my God, I know.
I didn't even notice that.
You didn't?
There's like five.
Yeah. We all picked the same voice. It's a very aristocratic British woman.
so funny.
So good.
Yeah. I didn't realize we did that.
We did.
I noticed it last time I was over and both of our characters were talking, and I was like, why? My character's not talking. Oh, it's Alyssa.
Oh, that's so funny. Yeah.
That checks.
I'm also not surprised by any of the races we've all chosen.
No,
at all.
I'm a slut for drow.
The fact that you and I both picked drow rogues.
Did. Yeah.
Zach's going to pick drow too, he said.
Yeah. That's not a shock
specifically
either.
Specifically the Seldarin drow, wolf drow. Yeah.
Well, of course the Githyanki at first, and it was so ugly.
But the Githyanki are like, oh, fucking pee. Like, every time I have to fight one of them, I just cry inside.
Dude, the way they disarm you is ridiculous.
Oh, so
absolutely ridiculous.
So many attacks. Like, I've fought a Githyanki monk once, and I was like, Alyssa.
That's what I was originally.
Should have done that.
At you.
Yeah, but I was mad at how ugly she was. I couldn't look at her face.
Their noses do get me.
Yeah, the nose and like their heads are really big.
That's why I couldn't romance Lazelle. I also don't hate myself that much.
Lazelle grew on me.
Lazelle, it was her personality that grew me. The fact that she was like,
and she's got a hot
mean.
Voice.
She was
does have
me.
A hot voice.
Yeah.
She was like, mean to me.
She bullied me, and I was like kind of into that.
Like that.
There's just high investment on the hotness.
It is.
Horniness.
Listen,
and the hotness.
If you can't tell, the
we're simple meetings. Creatures.
development meetings about that shit.
Yeah.
Honestly, I definitely did.
I could see it.
Yeah.
Just like that one time when Lazelle was like, oh, you won't have sex with me, then I'm going to fuck with. Will.
And then she did.
She didn't, though.
Oh, she did?
Oh, yeah.
Well, she tried. And then Will was like, let's look at the stars.
Let's look at the stars.
Like, she probably loved that.
Oh, Will.
Silly man.
She was mad about it. She's like, we could die tomorrow.
That's the thing, too. It's like, would you also like not want to fuck somebody if you thought you might die tomorrow?
If I was the leader of this camp, I would run through it. I'll tell you.
Run through it.
Multiple times.
Like a hurricane.
And then kill him.
Like, no! There you go.
Actually.
We might die tomorrow.
No, fantastic game. Feels way ahead of its time.
Yes.
Like, beautiful graphics, beautiful gameplay, insane dialogue and plot options and scenarios. Just anything you do, the smallest decision can
butterfly
make
effects.
Biggest, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's just incredible.
Insane
and
replayability.
So open world, it gives me anxiety. I'm so stressed all the time.
Same.
Yeah.
It's worth it. You, come across a crevice and it's a whole dungeon.
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's ridiculous.
Highly recommend.
Highly recommend.
Yeah. You will spend multiple weeks of your life.
I only got the game because it won Game of the Year.
It must be the game of the year, I will say.
It makes perfect sense. There's nothing that could have beaten this shit. Mm-hmm. Seriously. It's insane.
Yeah.
Has anyone played the older ones?
Zach has.
I have not.
Really?
Should we phone a friend? I'm just kidding.
Phone a friend.
Zach has. So he said that they're very similar, but this is obviously extremely expanded upon.
Yeah.
So very similar aspects, a lot of like similar lore and character development.
Taking the whole thing to 11.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right. So final thoughts on Baldur's Gate 3.
Horny.
Go play
Horny.
It.
Play it.
It'll take over your life, apparently.
Yeah. You won't regret it.
Yep.
But I like those kinds of experiences that create conversations and...
Yeah. And being able to have such different experiences, like being able to message and be like, this happened to me. And everybody's like, what?
How did you
no,
do
this
that?
Happened to me. It's so cool. It's,
yeah.
Because, Alan Wake 2 like another phenomenal game, obviously, but we play the same story,
mm-hmm.
you know, right. but like in this kind of game, everyone has a different experience, mm-hmm. and that is so much fun to talk about.
Yeah.
Well, it's fun talking about it today. Thanks.
I'm sorry that we took that over.
No. Everybody loves Baldur's Gate 3. I just haven't played it yet. I really, really, really want to.
Let us know when you do. Mm-hmm. Because
yeah, send us pictures of your character
experiences.
Let me in the group chat. You fuck.
Yeah.
No, seriously, we could make one.
Sneak in the group chat.
We should just do a Baldur's Gate group chat.
We should.
Yeah. Yeah. I want to hear about all your decisions and all your, like, who you wife up.
Yeah.
I feel like you would go for Jaheera too.
I can see that.
Yeah. I want to know all.
Ooh, nothing else. Just horny.
Come on.
All those decisions.
Jaheera broke my heart. She died. It was my fault.
Tragic.
No, I'm excited for you to play it. Definitely recommend it. I got like the collector's edition. No, not the collector's. Like the in between. It wasn't collector's. It was
like the $80 one.
Yeah, the upgraded one. Zach got it for me for Christmas, and it came with some cool outfits.
Nice.
Yeah. So I don't know if that's worth it.
That's another thing.
It was worth it for me because it was free.
Side note: I am obsessed with dyeing all of my clothes. I will just say that is something that
I forget about.
You can dye. You can have any color you want.
Yeah, it's I so should pretty. Dye Gale's clothes because I'm gonna make him like a pretty purple.
You can literally.
Oh, you should. Yeah. That'd be so good for him.
Because right now he's gold and it just doesn't fit him.
No, he's a very purple man.
He was hot and silver. Mm. But I feel like he needs some like more magic.
So it's also a dress-up game.
Yeah. Yeah. Practically Sims.
That's so good.
Sims, but fantasy. Dating Sims. Yeah. Sims nightlife.
Yeah. That's all.
All right. Sid, Jesse, thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you for having us.
We had a blast tonight.
Yeah.
Go play Baldur's Gate 3. Go play Rogue Legacy 2. Alan Wake 2. We'll have reviews up for all of those shortly.
Yes.
And plenty more to come in 2024. Thanks for hanging out with us tonight.
Goodbye.
With the clicker